But he goes, I can't.
Those folks are there. You're on.
Yeah.
You're on now.
We're on now. Okay. Right.
Call this regular meeting of Grand Forks Council to order. And ask the audience to keep it down. Usually Chair does that. And the first item is the adoption of the agenda. We have a couple of changes, conditions. Under bylaws, the late item from Gallery 2, and that is a request for fee for service, and we have a resolution crafted. And the other item is a late item. Our CAO is going to give a verbal presentation on the restoration of City Hall. So motion to accept the amended. Councillor Krog, Councillor Kendel, all those in favor. And we have two sets of minutes. We have the February 24th Committee of the Whole meeting, which was an exciting meeting. So can we have a motion to adopt those minutes? Councillor O'Doherty, Councillor Smith, all those in favor. And the February 24th regular meeting minutes, Councillor Wyers, seconded by Councillor Smith, all those in favor. And we are down to council reports, and I will take. Councillor Smith looks excited at the table.
Well, I have to keep my brief because my voice is not very good today.
Sexy, though.
All I have to report really is the Deer Committee meeting on a Friday. As a committee, we unanimously agreed that we'd like to keep the format as a formal committee of council for credibility with dealing with the government. And one resolution that came out of there was to have council direct staff to write a letter to the ministry, Steve Thompson, because we're still having some issues with whether or not. Sorry. With our environment ministry liaison, who may be Aaron Reed. I just got an email from him.
Right.
He said the decision hasn't yet been made, but we'd like to see if council could support a letter to the ministry to stand by the level of support that they offered us at the last UBCM.
So would you like to make that motion now and get it on the table and a seconder for that? Councillor Krog? And I totally agree with you. I think we're being squeezed in the middle here by some of the economizing they're doing with various positions. So that is one of them, the conservation officer. Yeah. So I think if you could help craft that letter with staff, we'll get something off to them.
Okay.
And
Also, I just wanted to let you know that my sustainable communities report is available to council, and I imagine it will be included in the next committee of the whole document package. So that's available on there.
Okay. Glad you're here this evening.
Thanks.
Councillor Krog.
I attended the downtown beautification open house. I think it was on the 27th or the 29th. That was well attended. I also went to the Rotary Spray Park open house. So they were getting the word out. People that were there seemed to be quite excited. And it was, when you look at the demographics, there was a couple of families with little kids, but there was a lot of grandmothers. So there was a large senior contingent there looking at it. The I also on Saturday dropped in impromptu at the public meeting for water meters that was being held downtown. Perfect weather, well attended. Some good points were brought up. The one that I'll just mention now through you for staff is can we look at when we water things? I thought that we were always doing it in the evening, but some people are saying hottest part of the day we're watering some of the parks, and if there's a reason for it, if it's a load reason, or if not, because they're saying, well, why can you do it when we can't do it? So if we could just double check that.
So when asked that we set a good example out there and we can refer to review that, I'm not sure.
Yeah, just to make sure, unless there's a reason, because I wasn't sure if the evening, the demand for other sprinklers or something like that, but it was pointed out that it was happening in a couple of parks, so I just wanted to bring that forward.
Okay.
And they had the masquerade ball, I was going to say last night, but it was Saturday night, and I think that's about it.
So that was what?
Yeah.
All right, thank you very much, Councillor, and Councillor Kendel.
Thank you, Worship. Due to a vacation with my grandchildren, I could only report on Legoland and Disneyland. That's why I don't have anything to report.
And the sunshine looks good. Councillor O'Doherty.
Yes, Your Worship, I attended the open house at the gallery for the water park. I went to John, sorry.
Spring Park.
Yeah, Spring Park. I call it Water Park, too. And I've been working on the budget with the staff for the last 2 weeks, and we're working hard to get the GFI on track. And in the next couple of weeks, we'll have all the name of their teams, and it'll be on the 25th of June, till the end of June.
Do you know whether they're planning to upgrade their sound system for this year?
They were talking about it.
Yeah.
Actually, they're having a meeting tonight at the community future at 7 o'clock, but I couldn't attend and I couldn't appear.
Yeah, we were into supporting that last year, but yeah, again, because we didn't do it.
So I'll make sure tomorrow I'll find out if they discuss it with the system.
Okay, great.
Okay? And that's for you tonight, Your Worship.
And Councillor Wyers, I'm sorry, I do think go around now.
Oh, I thought you were saving the best for last.
Well, because Patrick was last a couple times here. You're on.
Hey, thank you, Your Worship. Yeah. So I'll begin my report. February the 27th, I attended the Grand Forks Rotary Club's open house for their proposed spring park. And the open house is at Gallery 2, so the presentations were very informative. And it looks like we're well on our way to seeking the funding partners to achieve this attractive community facility for City Park. So just remember, anyone can make a donation. March 1st and 2nd, I was attending AKBLG executive meetings in Creston. This year's conference begins Wednesday, April the 9th, and it runs through to April the 11th. The theme this year will be ties. So you can take community ties or your tie. And they're going to, the host community has an excellent agenda set up for some fun-filled events for, you know, reception and that.
Creston.
Don't put Cranbrook. So I'm giving you a heads up.
Okay.
Bring your cowboy boots, your cowboy hats, and your formal wear.
Okay.
Okay.
Another fancy gun belt.
You need that.
Yeah. Dance lesson.
Oh, yeah. I got a surprise for you, Councillor. And of course, of key significance with AKBLG is the resolutions that we bring forward from the region each year. This year, there are 13 resolutions that will be carried to UBCM in September. And I do have a complete list of them, and they will be circulated to staff and council very shortly. They're just going over the draft endorsements and that from UBCM, because they did go down to UBCM for comments, and then they come back to us. So they will be on the floor at AKBLG for the membership to vote on. And from there, those that are endorsed will be carried forward to the September conference at Whistler for UBCM. And on March the 5th, I participated in the communication policy planning here at City Hall with Jan Mann. So that was very informative. And Councillor Krog, the city, the downtown revitalization was February 20th.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay. I forgot my calendar, yeah. So I forgot some other things.
So that was prior to the last meeting, so just to help you out there. So communications policy for the city of Grand Forks. I'm looking forward to having more opportunities to meet with our citizens here in Grand Forks and getting our message out there every possible way. March the 6th, the Grand Forks Flying Association, they held their regular meeting, and they're gearing up for the third annual Airport Appreciation Day in Flying. Did you get that? Gear up.
I did, I made a note.
Okay. So plans are well underway, and there'll be a runway theater for the children the night before called Planes, the Disney presentation at dusk on Saturday evening, the 23rd of August. So we'll have refreshments and that for the kids and prizes. March the 7th, I attended the Concerned Citizens for Water Meter in Pajaro Park. And March the 7th, I also facilitated, along with Teresa Taylor at the Boundary Women's Resource Center, the FCM Head Start Group from Grand Forks. And we met with Community Futures General Manager Wendy McCullough and Holly Hume, who is an employee of Community Futures, who has extensive work in social work and working with youth. The young ladies have come up with a project in the month of March for the Federation of Canadian Municipalities pilot project that they're involved in. And they've notably pointed out that there's no youth center here in Grand Forks. And so Wendy has a background in a number of youth centers around the province that were established in the past through Community Futures. So they were discussing the costs and all the work that is involved in putting together a proposal, a business plan. And what it brought us back to was the fact that, wow, where have we heard this? We're severely missing a community center here in Grand Forks, where, you know, something like this could take legs. So kudos to the young girls at the high school and in our Head Start group who know and feel the deficiency in our community for activities for at night. I mean, we've all got lots we can do during the day, but it's those that we need that place at nighttime. And I remember when I was growing up as a youth, we had our inner sanctum in Brandon where we could go at nighttime, and it was a good gathering place. But there's a lot of implications, liabilities and that for these young people to look at taking this on their own. And of course, it was an excellent experience for them to go through the motions, to discuss it with Community Futures. So we're looking farther into actually, they've been offered an opportunity to come before the Rotary Club and for the Rotary Act youth group and possible participation for rural communities in that respect for young people. So watch for further updates from our Head Start girls. And on March the 8th, I celebrated International Women's Day at the Boundary Women's Resource Center. There was an afternoon of entertainment and food and stories, and it was so well attended. And I have this beautiful t-shirt, black t-shirt with fuchsia across it. Said, this is what a feminist looks like.
I haven't worn those.
You don't. You should have worn them.
I should have.
And just a couple of meeting dates that are coming up. We have the Grand Forks Environment Committee meeting, which will be on Thursday, March the 20th, at 11 o'clock a.m. at the Regional District Boardroom here in Grand Forks at 2140 Central Avenue. And the Grand Forks and District Public Library, their regular monthly meeting is Wednesday, March the 19th at 4 o'clock p.m. And it's in the main lobby of the library, so both meetings are open to the public. And an upcoming agricultural land reserve session at Selkirk College on March the 12th, starting at 7:30 p.m. with MLA, former MLA, Corky Evans. He will be speaking regarding the agricultural land reserve that was created to protect farmlands across British Columbia for agriculture. So that should be also an interesting session. And of course, the AKBLG and Grand Forks will be hosting a community engagement conversation session. Now, this was publicized in a local newspaper, and because of the size of our venue, we don't have a community center, so we are lacking in space. So the invitation was for Wednesday, March the 12th, at the Omega Restaurant. So it is a community engagement roundtable session. It's a discussion session with our citizens, and we're looking for what are the key factors or issues that we see facing us in 2014 here in our community. And it's not to be a debate, and we're going to have a meeting with a facilitator that came highly recommended through KPLG and the Columbia Basin Trust. So that is my report for this evening, Your Worship.
Thank you very much. And I'll forego recovering most of the items already in the agenda, so I'll forego my own. Can I have a motion to adopt, accept the council reports? Councillor O'Doherty, second. Councillor Kendel, all those in favor. Regional District. Can take a deep breath here.
Yeah.
Well, I have to say, the prelude to this is that I did speak to a number of councillors individually, and there was some intention on my part to kind of bring this to an informal meeting or to bring it in camera, but in fact, it doesn't really fit the agenda at all. So we have in front of us a fairly decent new bylaw from the regional district, but it doesn't include cats. And we're being asked to sign again and make a commitment for the next year, you know, that we commissioners for a one-year period. And that is coming quickly to an end. And the city is being asked to confirm our participation in this service ongoing now. They'll be looking for a multi-year contract, and it'll be basically at the levels, or Roxanne and I went over the last year's budget, so it's gone up from about 120 to around 140 in that range. Don't hang me on the details. But my concerns in a nutshell are really simple. We are committed to making jobs in our community. At this point in time, the commissionaires are a subcontractor that are hiring two people within our communities at wages that are considerably lower than what I think the job requires. They were here and met with us and were refused basically to talk about the wages they were paying. They do charge 40% administration fee on that $140,000. Plus, we also pay the regional district an administration fee for carrying that service that we share with Christina Lake, Greenwood, Area D, and ourselves. I think it's overpriced. My preference would be that we had something like we had in the past, where we had some animal humane services and we dealt with cats. And to do that, though, you know, the city doesn't want to be the runner of the service. That way, we had a nonprofit society in between ourselves and the service. We have the SPCA that pulled out of town a few years ago. VCSPCA, because of our lack of volunteers and support, there was something went on. I don't claim that we need to go back into the history of it. You know, my preference at this point is that we really hold back on this and look to set up a better system for our community that includes some humane services. To me, that would be adoptions and various kinds of other volunteer activities that were going on in the past.
Yeah.
We do have the building, which we lease to the regional district, so there are complications to our relationship in this regional shared service. So that's my two cents worth here. I find myself in a real bind here in terms of whether I support another contract with the commissioners. On the good side, there have been very few complaints about the commissioners. They've run a very smooth, it seems, smooth service. And it's been extremely nice for the regional district not to get bothered. But for 40% plus the administration fee, that's my pitch. Open for comments. Councillor Wyers.
So
we have to sign this. The city of Grand Forks has to sign on at the regional district table at the upcoming meeting at the end of March.
We'll be asked to commit ourselves to a renewed contract with commissioners. So signing, I'm using that literally, but in fact, it's agreeing to that budget.
Well, your worship, can we have a meeting with our CAO? He was absent earlier today for family reasons. Should we honor if this is within our scope or?
Comments, Mr. Allen?
Sure, Mr. Mayor. I think the discussion could be had with council on looking at options within, for the service. You're right in the amount of money that we do pay. They did say, suggested it was a 40% administration fee, plus the regional district would have an administration fee on that. What other options do we have? We'd have to explore those options. I know the regional district, when they presented it to us in, I sat in at the meeting, I didn't participate in the meeting. They did present the they had looked at other options. But from our council's perspective, I think it would be a good option for us to consider that our next council meeting, hearing some more information from the regional district on what other options there were and what type of agreement we're looking to enter into, how long we're looking to enter into that agreement, and what are the options that's in that contract for it going up, what are the incremental increases going to look like. I think there's a lot of information that our city should be aware of in that respect when it comes to that. So, I think we can hear some more information.
Councillor Kendel from Councillor Wyers.
Yeah, I think from my perspective, pretty much everything that the city does goes up to some type of a tendering process, and I don't believe that, other than the commissioners bid on this regional contract, was there any other participants who were interested in doing it? Like, how did they come to pick this provider and come to this contract?
Well, as many of you know, we had a tough time with the previous contract that we had with the individuals in the community. It didn't go well for a number of reasons, including the fact we didn't have a good bylaw to deal with. But in fact, the commissioners were invited to apply. So there wasn't really an open competition, an open bid on this. There was a reluctance to go to an offering of that kind because I think the group felt that they were burned in the last choice they made and ended up making a lot of work for the regional district. Councillor Wyers, then Councillor Krog.
Well, Your Worship, I agree with our CAO. I think we should hear from the regional district. I think they should have an opportunity to come to speak to us so we know what the terms are, what it's going to cost, and everything. My concern is that they don't take cats. And I mean, they're all animals. I mean, and the fact that we don't have an adoption center.
Yeah.
I mean, I would volunteer at an adoption center.
Well, and my memory of it when I worked there was that we had 40 or 50 volunteers that came in and helped out with various kinds of walking the dogs and cats. And
I just feel that that's part of a community when you have that type of a...
Looking after our pets.
Yeah, looking after our pets. Yeah, I just don't. So, I haven't liked the idea that the animals are, the dogs are shipped out of our community.
Although that may in fact be an anomaly because it's harder to find homes for big dogs and stuff. But if we can adopt things locally, great. But we don't have that kind of thing now. So my understanding then is that we're going to ask for the RD to talk to us directly about this budget, but this service rather, and that we would expect to be able to ask questions and determine whether or not we continue to, I guess the bottom line is, continue to fund it. I mean, if you call for a service review, you basically say, we're not going to fund it, so tell us what we do now. So we're not. This is not a service review. This is a preliminary. Let's hear from you and hear some of the details of the service. And I really appreciate that because it takes me off the hot plate right now with this.
Do you need a motion?
No, I don't believe so. I think that that's
good. Let's get a motion.
So, all right. And when Councillor Wyers makes it, Councillor Krog seconds. Discussion, the wording on it, I guess we can leave that. Basically, we understand that we're asking for them to come.
Just I wanted to comment on it. I feel the same that we used to have that service. I used to support it. I think four of my cats came from there. Yeah, crazy cat guy. And my dogs, though,
One came out of Trail and one came out of San Mar. It wasn't anything local anymore, and I didn't like the fact that we went from animal care to just straight enforcement for dog. But the problem that we did face in previous years was a zoning issue and how many people were actually capable of doing it, that were willing to apply and stuff. The nice thing about something like an SPCA, it comes with that volunteer structure, as opposed to any private individuals that, you know, would bid on the contract and stuff. But I would like to see something where it goes back to, or not backwards, but forwards into something that takes care of some of those other issues rather than just, you know, stray dogs.
It certainly seems inconsistent with the rest of our, you know, our community and our approach.
And maybe we can revisit BCSBCA.
I would certainly be interested in opening those discussions with them. Councillor.
The contract we got now, does it go to the end of 2014?
No, I believe it's to the September of this year, but again, their budgeting process is coming up, so that's the deadline we're facing. Is the start date on that contract with them, I think, was in the fall of last year, but in fact, we're being asked now to roll that over into a longer-term contract.
Okay.
All right. Thank you very much, Council, and can I have a motion to accept the report from the Regional District? Councillor Smith, Councillor Kendel, all those in favor? Okay. Get back on track. My soapbox off.
Well done.
All right. First of all, the manager of development engineering, the fiber optic network, which again, we looked at in detail this morning. So I don't know, Council, whether there's any desire at this point to revisit any of the details of this, although Councillor Smith and Councillor Krog, you could certainly ask some questions on it. It was an exciting plan that looks at making some offers to business and industry that would give us an opportunity to have a revenue stream. It's really well put together. I think Daniel Drexler is was a key player in putting that report together.
Yeah, I had a chance to go through it, Worship, and it was very comprehensive.
So we're looking for a motion to approve the fiber optic network plan. Councillor Wyers, Councillor O'Doherty.
I'd like to bring that motion that Council approves the community fiber optic network plan and authorizes staff to proceed with offering value-added technology services to community organizations, local businesses, and other local government, I guess.
Excellent. The seconder was Councillor O'Doherty. Discussion? Question? All those in favor? Excellent. Thank you. The next item of business is the West Coast Amusements, who are wanting to use a property located on 72nd Avenue west of Dick Bartlett for their amusement park.
Yep.
And Councillor O'Doherty, you're making the motion?
Yes.
Councillor Smith seconds it. And I'm assuming here that we've had a fairly good relationship in past with this company.
We
haven't had a lot of difficulties with them.
Is there any discussion?
Do you want to discuss it?
Well, I was just wondering, that's right next door to Silver Kettle, isn't it?
Actually, it's not. It's over on the other side, is it not? It's more.
I think it's right beside
the car. Oh, here I was.
Yeah. Just
no
distance there.
I think they would enjoy it.
I would.
Okay. Sasha?
Yes, Your Worship. It's located right beside the Dick Bartlett Park field.
Yeah. So it's between Silver Kettle and Dick Bartlett.
Yeah,
Park.
We're
more than enough. Park, yeah.
It's right on the edge.
Yep.
Have we held that there since Silver Kettle went in?
Oh, no.
So this would be the first experience, I guess. We'd be open to feedback from this.
Well, we would, Mr. Mayor, we would let them know that we're doing the council does approve it, we'll let them know that we're doing it, and what the hours would look like and those types of things, so they'd be able to prepare for it. Because I believe it'll only be for 2 days?
Five days?
By the time they sit down and take
Down. And invitation.
And which?
And invitation.
All right, we have a motion on the floor. There will be no elephants in this.
Rush a couple of people and they're doing elephants.
All right, question, all those in favor?
Opposed?
The next item of business is the Happy Days Diner amendment to the application for a liquor license. So we have been supporting them in their application for a liquor license. This is to really expand it to the concept of having sock hops and hosting banquets and parties that would provide, would offer opportunities for groups to go there. And could I have a motion on that, Councillor Wyers?
I'll take that motion.
Councillor Smith? And discussion on this matter? Who votes against?
I like sock hop. Yeah, but those 50 Street gangs, the Jets, you know, they get out of control.
Okay.
Maybe we can wear our roller skates.
Well, I think right now, more culture for the city, more entertainment and interesting things. And, you know, there's a business owner that's working real hard to make her establishment successful. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. And bringing us down to the early budget approval for the improvements to Dick Park Electrical in the tune of $10,000. Capital reserve funds, so these are coming from our reserve accounts for this purpose. Electrical upgrades are what we're putting in here. So it would have multiple user groups and things that we do. Councillor O'Doherty? Councillor Kendel, any discussion?
No.
This is early budget approval. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. And early budget approval for the Spragett Bridge tubing parking lot. Good discussion this morning on this matter. And again, we clarified that we have a $17,000 reserve that we're going to tap from our old parking reserve, and that we'll look for $25,000 to complete that $42,000 capital project from either the ministry, or we would go searching, if we don't get that, for other sources of funding. Can I have a motion for that, Councillor? Second, and Councillor Kendel. Discussion? Great stuff.
Would that be ready before this season?
Yep.
Mr. Mayor, the reason that we have to start this process now is the tree removal process, the nesting season. So any of the little trees and stuff that we'd be taking out, we'd have to do our consultation with the Ministry of Environment, give them notification of our works, and yes, yeah, so we'd have it ready for this tubing season.
I think these amenities in the city really are supported by people that walk down to the beach. Yes. You know, a tremendous addition to recreation. And again, I see this in the same category, that it is going to provide something. Basically, it's finding which way people are going and helping them go that way. That's the favorite spot.
And making it safe.
Yeah, and making it safe. Motion on the floor. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. And early budget approval on well number 3, the vertical turbine replacement. So we had pictures of that earlier.
Yep.
With the sloppy connection, vertical connection. So we need to spend $40,000 from the capital reserve fund on that. Councillor O'Doherty.
Okay.
Second, Councillor Smith. Discussion? Or we got to trust our engineers to be right.
Just what is the lifetime of
that kind of a vertical turbine replacement?
Mr. Mayor, there's a lot of influences that happen that can create the life expectancy on that, but I would say to you it's probably between the shaft would be between 30 and 50 years. That would be an estimate at this point. But like I said, it is this location right here where the shaft is wobbling, where the packing gland is, but this goes all the way down into the aquifer, and then there's a screen in here. And what it does is it draws water in from the aquifer, and it draws it up through these different stages, and then pushes it up to our reservoir from there. So,
excuse me.
Okay, do we have that on the floor? I'm sorry.
Yep.
Yes. Question? All those in favor? And we're down to information items. This is the terms of reference for the solid waste management plan, which is a region-wide, regional district initiative. The steering and monitoring committee at this point is asking for representation from the Grand Forks community. So what I'm putting out at this point is that it looks as if with the balance of politicians on this group already, that it would be useful to have a community citizen sit in on the survey information that leads this off, without a commitment to being on the long-term steering committee. But we do need to find someone from our community. So I'm asking on camera here tonight into the audience, if you are interested, to pass your name on to Mr. Allen. And we would appreciate having Grand Forks representation. We are leading the pack in terms of what we're doing here with the waste diversion program that we're into, and also being host to the waste site that we are. We should be in a position where we have a clear input into this process. And a motion to receive. Councillor Kendel, Councillor O'Doherty, receive information and refer to staff. All those in favor? Carried. Bylaw Enforcement Officer, Highway 3 Unsightly update. We need to review this situation at this point. You've read over the report. Mr. Copan, we can just receive it for information. I think it's great that there is a follow-through that we've never had before on these kinds of situations. I'm not sure we need to go into the detail of it tonight. Motion to receive. Councillor Wyers, Councillor O'Doherty. Any further questions? All those in favor? That's kind of slow off to Mark. Did you guys have some questions?
No.
Councillor Smith?
No, nothing like crazy for a second.
Oh, okay. I'm so sensitive to your face. And the next item of business, and we discussed this again this morning in a fair amount of detail, the situation with the Arts District, the Arts Council, and the fact that we are in this position of sorting out last year's situation and funding them for this year. We also openly encourage them to look for support from the regional district. So a motion at this point to go ahead with the approval of this funding to the Arts Council. Councillor Wyers, Councillor Krog. Further discussion on this? Councillor Kendel.
Yeah, just reading the thing here, and it still states, I believe, that it's contingent on the agreement for fee for service with the city. So are those negotiations done already?
No.
So then the funding is still contingent on that?
Yes. Yeah, so we're going to approve it, but they're going to bring forward a discussion or a paper indicating what the service is that they're providing, matching to our policy.
Thank you.
Ready for the question on this? All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. And the next item is from Grace McGregor, Chair of the Regional District. Summary of intro items for provincial review of the ALC. So this is the 12th meeting, which is Wednesday at the
Seniors Hall. No, Selkirk College.
Sorry. Okay, yes, it was at Selkirk College.
Selkirk College, yeah.
Corky Evans will be there and chairing and having input. So it's unfortunate that it's overlapping with the other report. Received for discussion. Motion, Councillor Krog, Councillor O'Doherty. And further discussion on this?
Hello, Corky.
Well, I don't know. What do you feel about, we're kind of moving fast here. Let's get some meat on the bone.
Okay.
How do you feel about the Agricultural Land Commission?
For most of it, it's actually really good. Some things municipalities and the ALR have not seen eye to eye somewhat, but the protection of farmland is a benefit to all communities. But sometimes they're, say, rock shelves or ALR. It's like, unless you're growing those little air plants, right? So there's been some stuff, and Corky and I.
So could I?
Never mind.
Could I interpret council's support in general for the ALR?
Yes.
We're saying basically, well, what they're wanting to do is give more power to municipalities.
Yes.
Yeah.
And that's a important step.
Yep.
Yeah. Do you think that's good or bad?
I think that's good.
Well, there are a lot of people think it's bad.
Well, I think it's good.
Yeah.
You asked my opinion.
Some municipalities are perceived as wanting to use up a lot, and I'll just say the coast.
You want to leave politicians in charge of your farmland.
But it's, there are certain times when it makes sense in a small town.
Yeah.
Like our airports in the ALR.
We traded land for that, though.
Yeah. So, you know, it's a good system. There's just, historically, there's been some flaws, but more input makes for a better system.
Okay. Beat this up enough?
Yeah.
Thank you very much for your input. And
well, there are other implications in our province, too, with the oil and gas industry.
Yeah.
That's the big gap. So, you know, you got to get everybody in the picture here.
All right, we have a motion to receive for discussion. All those in favor?
Texas, the cows, the roundup, the little rigs.
And the tenant governor's program on promoting music and community spirit, received for information.
I will receive it.
Councillor Krog makes the motion, seconded Councillor O'Doherty. Discussion?
It should be. Did you say something about it? Because we are being filmed so that it could go up to the community. I was going to report on it last time, but I think last time I forgot my calendar as well.
They are looking in particular for a theme song.
Yeah.
And asking for community groups and organizations to participate in writing music and words to a theme song. Councillor Wyers.
For our anniversary.
Yeah. Maybe we should give this to the Boundary and District Arts Council.
I would be surprised if they didn't get the same notification.
I hope they have. They have seen it.
Yeah.
But maybe we can make sure.
We could ask Michelle when we see her.
Yeah.
They've got hold of that. Yeah, that would be the group to circulate it, for sure.
They've got the Coral Society.
Yeah, it's actually kind of a neat idea.
And I guess it has to be a country song as part of that.
It could be hip hop.
All right, and down to number F, which is the phase two of the downtown beautification open house. We had people use sticky notes, which
yes.
is one of the things that Councillor Krog has suggested we do here in these council meetings to indicate some of their likes and dislikes about the presentation. So there were some really interesting ideas. I don't know whether we want to review some of those general comments.
There's the one listing that hits most of the items. Yeah, this one has that one.
Yeah. And love the trees, more gathering, our gathering places. Love the roundabout suggestions. Expensive but visually interesting. Please ask Radio Shack to refurbish the fountain.
Yeah.
Central Avenue, 4th Street, much more inviting. Great job with the beautification. Clean up the northeast lot. Where is that? I'm not sure which one that is.
Second Central. Across from the old hotel.
Yeah. That one. Right. Okay. That has been empty for a long time with a lot of signage and stuff. Using the slag is awesome. Need history of the slag. Very proud of our newly revised downtown core. I don't know whether I'll go through all of these. They are in available.
Yes.
Yeah.
Let me say the last one.
Which was?
I love Martino.
Where do you see that?
Right in the bottom. Oh, here.
Yeah. Okay. I love my town.
I love my town. Does that sound like a song?
Oh, there you go.
But really, that's such a good exercise. And Councillor Krog's idea of getting people to write down notes if they're not comfortable with speaking out in a meeting is a great idea, too. And we could be doing that if council agrees to experiment with it at our next meeting. We'll have sticky notes or whatever, and we could get them out at the beginning.
Yeah.
Little cards. And then collect them by the end, so when we come to question period, we could answer the questions on the paper. Is that the process?
Yeah.
I think it's worth trying out for a council meeting. Councillor Kendel.
I think Les had made a suggestion that we had some viewers this morning that his application now would allow them to actually send us questions while they're watching the council meeting, and maybe those could be asked and answered as well.
How many viewers tonight?
We have four right now.
Is that an all-time high?
We got five. This morning was five.
Yep.
Well, let's experiment with those inputs from the general public this way. And so a motion to receive for information. Councillor Wyers, Councillor Kendel, all those in favor. And the next item is the decommissioning of septic and underground fuel tanks. Again, we're receiving this sort of information tonight. It's quite an extensive report and talks about a number of risk factors in a small community like ours that has a history of oil tanks.
Yeah.
Councillor Krog.
Yeah, do you want me to make the motion to receive before the
Certainly, receive for information. Councillor Wyers seconds it, and discussion.
Yeah, I see they're talking about metal detectors and stuff. I don't, obviously the 50s and 60s in Grand Forks were before my time, but most small towns went for the above ground. I'm not sure if the below ground fuel tanks was a common thing in here, was it?
Yeah, there was one.
It was? Yeah. I know for, like, we think of septic tanks nowadays as being fiberglass or concrete, but there's been, well, Fran dug up one that was like an old 36 Packard or something. They buried the car, punched a hole through the window and ran, and that was the septic tank, right? So there are still a few of those out there. So I just wasn't sure about the underground fuel.
Yeah.
I know the underground septic cars are there.
Councillor Wyers.
Yes, Your Worship, thank you. And once again, as Zamorski cheats our staff member has alluded to the fact that this was raised by our local environment committee. And so I'm happy to see that this is moving forward. And yes, we actually know of an individual that sits on the environment committee whose husband dug up three cars last fall.
Popular.
That were used as septic fields.
So
that's what prompted us to dig into this a little farther and approach the city to investigate oil tanks and the abandonment.
So
thank you.
The question is, who pays for it all, right? Then
the landowner.
Mr. Allen,
Mr. Mayor, a way to regulate it too would be through building permit process or further investigation that an environmental assessment would have to be completed on a property before a building permit would be distributed to a house. So it's a real challenge for local governments to get into this because people are reluctant to let them have them go onto the property because there's a risk that they might find that they have a $10,000, $15,000, $20,000 expenditure that they're not willing to look
right.
at. If they're selling the property, they have to do a property disclosure paper, which they would check off a few boxes whether they had a septic system or not, or if they knew was it their closed or decommissioned property. There is a big risk to this that people would be reluctant to have us go onto their properties. The positive though is if there was a process in place, we could put it into the building inspection process that therefore prior to anybody getting a building permit, they would have to have that disclosed. One of the reports that I read on them too is that the likelihood of there being a lot of material in there is with the old tanks and stuff is not going to be a big impact, but there is a danger that they might not be aware of that they could have a sinkhole created in their backyard as a result of a septic tank failure, especially if it's one of these old cars. So there's a lot of positives to it as well.
Councillor Kendel.
Yeah, I'm just I don't really have an issue with it. I think sometimes we look for problems that aren't necessarily problems, but I'm wondering why the city would be, why we would be willing to take this on and not have a discussion with the regional district. I'm guessing there's probably as many or more of these issues outside of city limits. And if we're all not going to participate in, you know, in an effort to alleviate a potential problem, you know, I don't feel, you know, I have an issue, I guess, with us always wanting to champion some of these things when we're not, when everyone isn't participating.
Right, we're not going out there with metal detectors now looking for people's.
But we're suggesting we may.
Well, we're suggesting that we're looking at the problem now, and we haven't done that before, so.
Yeah, but has it been a problem, is what I'm asking.
Well, certainly it has been a problem on different properties at different times. Mr. Wong.
Mr. Mayor, there is no action outlined that we are going to be taking any action at this point. It is simply an information report for council to consider from, and we're not even asking council to make a decision on it. We're putting it out there. So what will happen now is council will give that opportunity to think about it, introduced into conversation pieces.
Yeah.
The Environment Committee will now have some information that they will be able to talk about. And then from here, it may turn into a notice of motion coming from a councillor. They take a lot of time, but it really doesn't have any specific actions attached to it. More for information.
Just that make you more comfortable, Councillor Kendel.
Yeah, well, I just have one more statement, if I may, and that's, was there ever, when you had an oil appliance installed in your house, as you do now with a gas, you would have to have a permit or some type of documentation that would have been registered somewhere? And rather than kind of going on a hunting expedition, maybe there is already some documentation as to where these tanks were put in, and if that information is available, the homeowners that at least would have that documentation could be.
Could at least let those people know that are on record.
Yeah, and I'm not, I don't know whether there ever was, but this conversation came up at the UBCM or some conference I was at, and apparently there was at some point somewhere where you had to register these things. So that there may be some information.
Do you use a Ford or a Chevy as your Chevy?
Yeah. We had a problem on one of the houses on the corner of Central and 10th Avenue. You had to pull the house off the foundation and take all the basement out, sidewalks, and the have to put a new base and everything. Cost about $100,000.
And what was the problem there?
The oil tank.
The oil tank leak.
We went on under the foundation and down by the street, the city sidewalk.
A decommissioned tank?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so there are certain potential problems, and at least we've had this brought forward now for some preliminary discussions, but this is not an action item. All right, and the motion to receive for information. Councillor Wyers, Councillor Smith, further discussion? All those in favor? And we're down to bylaws.
Yeah.
This is the financial plan bylaw number 1996. Council gives first two readings to bylaw number 14, or bylaw for 2014-2018 financial plan bylaw.
Yeah.
Councillor O'Doherty, Councillor Smith. Can we do first and second reading together here? So this is the first and second reading for Councillor O'Doherty.
Yeah.
Question or comments?
This includes the amendments that we made today.
Yes, and it does not. Our CFO commented on that this morning to me that it does not. Mr. Allen.
Mr. Mayor, at this point right now, this is the introduction of the bylaw, and we walked through council and the community through the whole process on the delivery of the budget process. So the legislative obligation is that council will then, after the second reading, we'll be going to an open house process on it. So if there's any amendments, those would then be brought forward to council at the third reading. And then finally on the adoption, there'd be a rest period between the adoption and the fourth reading. So there'd be a couple more council meetings in there. But if there's any minor amendments, which there are after today, there was the Arts Council piece that'll be added into that. And then council will see those additions and we'll bring them forward.
All right. Thank you. So this is for first two readings. Councillor O'Doherty makes the motion, or Councillor Wyers made the motion. Who made that motion?
Well, I said I made it.
Councillor O'Doherty and Councillor Smith seconded. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. And we have another bylaw
before we move forward, and this is the Gallery 2 request for fee-for-service agreement in the amount of $142,000. Motion crafted is resolved that council directs staff to include the request from Steve Howlett, President of Gallery 2 Board, regarding the fee-for-service agreement for Gallery 2 in the amount of $142,000 in the 2014-2018 financial plan. Can I have that motion? Councillor Kendel, Councillor O'Doherty, discussion. Councillor Kendel.
Thank you, Worship. And again, if I understood correctly, Mr. Howlett had mentioned this morning that the negotiations were still, or were finalized with city staff as to what that fee-for-service was. Or have they been finalized?
Mr. Mayor, the finalization of the agreement will require us to pinpoint down the campground piece from the management of the campground. So those pieces in there, because what happens is we take some bookings and we're not always available for bookings. City staff will still continue to be able to provide that service. We would ask them to manage that from that perspective, because they're the ones that work with the visitor information center, works with the tourism people, the tourism guides. They have the ability to take the bookings at Gallery 2. So we're just working on that, the final pieces of that.
Yes, that's what he was referring to, I think. Councillor Kendel. And Councillor Wyers?
So this fee-for-service, is it just the 1 year, or?
Yes.
Are we doing a multi-year?
I don't, are we doing a multi-year?
Mr. Mayor, as far as that goes, typically we've had a three-year process, a three-year agreement, but the resolution does not read as a three-year agreement. And like I said, if they were presenting today or they were only looking for a 1 year, it would come again before council next year for that agreement to be renewed. And it's a healthy part of the budget process to remind council of the process. The money that's provided to them is, and they talked about it today in the presentation about all the services that you do provide. So it's a good reintroduction of the process back to the community for all the services that you do provide.
So even though we have a three-year contract with them, we would review the budget every year that they present?
I would recommend that, but we won't. At this point right now, the resolution is for us to not just a one-year agreement. So it'll give the council the opportunity to always consider that.
Okay, so it won't be a three-year agreement. Councillor Wyers?
Well, I just wanted to add that it has been in effect now for 5 years, and it's been growing. And I'm wondering if they're looking at coming back the other way, being a little more independent of the sum of money that they're seeing from the city?
I don't know.
Well, because they alluded to the fact that they're facing challenges, so I'd like to know what those challenges are that they're facing.
Mr. Allen?
If it's going to grow, we should know.
Mr. Mayor, one of the things that we talked about in the conversation was, the council is going to be challenged with, in the next course of the next year, with making financial decisions regarding the asset management planning, is what they can afford and what they can't afford. And that report will come forward later on this year. We're going to talk about all the services that we provide and what levels we provide. Council has made it clear that they would like to see people kind of reducing the amount that they're asking for. And they saw that from the Habitat for Humanity. It was a good example in that respect, where all the agencies came together. I don't think at this point right now there was really any, I hadn't heard any intention from them, but I know that they were applying for was it a museum grant of some sort, or maybe that was Mr. Mayor, that was a museum. That was a museum, yes. But they hold this museum distinction right now, when they get a grant or something along those lines. But no, there was no discussion about it going backwards. They have not made that motion. The council hasn't asked that in the other direction for them to consider options to become self-funded.
Well, just noted that in their presentation, they were talking about challenges that we're facing. So if there's going to be those challenges, it's good that we have a one-year window.
Okay, Councillor Krog.
Yeah, I think any organization like that faces challenges on a daily basis, especially when there's some other levels of government funding and that type of thing. I thought last year it was, I know at one time it was $170,000, and I thought last year it was $150,000. So this...
$130,000 last year.
$130,000? Okay, I thought it was $150,000.
$130,000, it went up by 12.
I thought we were going down by 8. Never mind.
Okay, that's the motion that's on the floor. Ready for the question? All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. And bringing us to a late item, our CAO is going to give us a presentation on the restoration of City Hall over at.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Mr. Mayor, we've been working with the consultant through the insurance company to bring back the design stuff for from the staffing perspective. Basically, meeting with all of our staff, meeting to see what all the needs were from a needs assessment, providing room for growth in the change to City Hall as we rebuild after the fire. What you see here is an image of the old post office as the prior to it becoming City Hall way back when. But here's the post office boxes, and here's some of the old wood flooring that we lost during the fire that was still part of the that was a significant loss for us. And you can see up top where the crown moldings were, and the windows are all original windows from that time, the weighted windows. So there's a lot of features in there that we're trying to carry that theme forward as
and
we
the four pillars.
And the pillars, yes, the pillars are an interesting piece. So what we've done is we worked with Hatch Design. We went through within our purchasing policy to seek a consultant to provide us a service, and they provided us some options, so I'll walk you through those today. Here we're looking at the floor plan for City Hall, so here's an aerial view. Here's the entrance on Market Street, and here's the entrance on 4th Street. So basically we have the front counter area here, and I'll go through some more photographs here shortly. But here's a carpeted area. You can see the carpeted with the small cubicle offices. The stairway going up to the council chambers upstairs. The reestablishment of these offices along here. The change of putting the photocopier and more of the equipment back in this area into a properly ventilated area, which we're required to have because of the emissions that come off those pieces of equipment and the chemicals that are in them. And then the washrooms in the back area here are basically being moved from this little area right here, which will now be an office. As we walk through here, there's another topographical view. It's not a very good picture from this point, but you can see that the same thing here. Some of the floor plan, we'll go into some more of these details, but the wood scraping, you'll see a little bit more of those features here shortly. The tile on the front entranceway, we're actually looking at using the front entranceways from Market Street and from 4th Street to allow us to better serve the customers. We're also going to be seeking some input from the customers on how we can serve them better from the access to City Hall. The staffing component and the offices, we've made room for the future by adding in opportunities for some smaller office spaces, but it'll allow us the opportunity to grow as we grow as a community for the future of our community. So as we look at this, this is another view from the top end. With the lighting features, they're a little bit more contemporary. These will be the light fixtures that you'll see in the City Hall that'll have lighting that goes up and down to get away from these incandescent bulbs to better for our staff. We find that a lot of staff that get sitting under these bulbs are hard on people's eyes for a long period of time. These will be little cubicle offices that you see here. So you can see they have little tops on them. They don't go to the ceiling. They're short of the ceiling. And you'll see as we go up through here that the light allows light to basically move through City Hall. The idea behind this was to reuse, think about recycling, think about features that are distinct to the community, the color palette from the branding, to try to keep it very representative of the community from the front pieces. And we're going to be looking for some input on that here shortly. But here's one example of where you come in off of 4th Street, coming in the old front entranceway. You can see that we've added some seating components for the customers that aren't able to stand at the counter, which would be right here, which is a multi-level counter that wraps around. But the counter would be made on slag, and the seating elements would allow the older customers to be able to sit down, spend a little bit more time, like you're at the insurance agent or something like that. We have a front finish here. You can see that we're not settled on this yet. This is where we're going to be looking for a little bit more input. Here's the branding. We've thought about the old branding too to see where maybe we can get it as part of the history. And you'll see a couple more options as we move through this. But see, making sure that we don't lose the history of the community as these changes have happened that have happened to City Hall. So one of the ideas was to maybe potentially add in the old etchings, or you'll see some post office options here shortly. Here's the mail piece. You can see that there's the they would etch that into the glass or the wood. You still have the branding here, but you can see that there was the post office, so they're trying to bring a little bit of that back. The piece here is a security piece that will drop down at night so we can allow the customers to come in at night to go upstairs for council meetings. Again, maintain the seating area. One of the features that we haven't highlighted is on this side right here will be a little bit more of a private room, so, but an open area where customers can go in and they can talk when they're potentially taking out a cemetery plot or dealing with an overdue account or something to that effect, but we can deal with it in a little bit more of a private area. Again, you can see a little bit more on the front counter here, some options. So the post office piece is a little bit more of a glass mirror piece. We've contemplated even putting up the visions of council on those pieces there. So as you come in the front door, you can kind of see the history of the community in that respect, because City Hall, and every time you talk about the things that happened in the community, you can go in and you can see they were a result of different councils that have happened, representation of the community. This would be coming in from Market Street, so you'd come in this way, and again, you can see the counter here, it wraps around. This is where 4th Street would be over here, but this is utilizing the space now. This is a bit of a closed-off area, but again, taking it up to the front counter. We integrated an option of the wood just for making sure that we're looking at our resources, what built the community. We know that logging is an integral part of the community. We know the slag's been an integral part of the community, so we're trying to make sure we bring those pieces back. You can see the acoustic ceilings up here, and these are the lights that you'll see as they drop down. Trying to replicate some of the history that was there with those big molded crown molding ceilings are going to be very hard to replace, but they were buried before against underneath some of these tiles, so it's a bit of a challenge. We talked a little bit about the acoustic pieces and the sound barriers, trying to be contemporary with the design. Their designer has provided us some options. You can see the floor and the carpet are fragmented as they come together, just a little bit more of the coming together of the resources. The acoustic pieces, again, for the separation, these are just the ideas at this point. Topographical view, again, this is Market Street over here, and this is coming in. This is how the floor plan would look out. It's a more ergonomical option for our staff, and it's also a better facility for serving our customers. We feel at this point right now, we've talked to people in our staff who are dealing with customers when they're coming in on a regular basis. How do we serve them better? So again, some of the new changes will be these offices in this area right here. These offices were non-existent before. This is where we used to have the photocopier or the workstation right here. And the photocopiers used to be over in this area here, which is all framed in. This will be the hallway here. And you can see right here the glasses on the tops here will allow the lights from the windows to shine through so we can utilize more natural light inside the building. Again, here's a highlighting that feature so the light will come in through here and carry its way through. The posts do go all the way to the ceiling. You can see that these are just to show you what they would look like from the mounted perspective. The tiling, again with the black and white being very generic, but these would be the washroom area coming in from the photocopier area here, and then having a bench for laying out the council agendas and the developing agendas, and having the washrooms in a little bit more of a private area. Talking about the history, the sustainability, the black and white with the wood, trying to keep it very interpretive in that respect, again, meeting with the branding pieces. The post office theme, trying to continue on with the history of the building. You can see here with the acoustic pieces and these will be actually functional the way that they're laid out. The history and the contemporary pieces here is trying to utilize the old with the new and make it feel current, but keeping some of the older features in place. That's the important piece here in the designer. We said that one of the things that we want to make sure that we're presenting up to the public is as we talk about, you know, here's what we need from an operational perspective, but how can we portray that image back to what we had there before and utilize some of the older materials. The slag, you can see here, utilizing the slag, because they make countertops out of the slag now, so we'd like to make sure that we're utilizing some of our slag in that respect. The recyclable carpeting, the tile carpeting, so like you see in this room here, so you don't have to take up all the carpet. If you do have some damage, you can replace a tile. And the wood floors, bringing back the wood floors, I mean, they're very important piece of to City Hall, and it's an environmentally, from our perspective, working environment is a better environment for us. So again, we bring this forward to council tonight. We are going to put it down with a few boards at some key locations. The staff have been working to get the locations defined. I believe we're going to be at the the museum, I'm sorry, the library, the art gallery, and the pool. And we're going to be seeking comments again, so people will be able to provide their comments on how we can serve them better. But again, coming back to council on this question, it's going to be really, what is the front counter area going to look like from the historical pieces? We know that we're working with the Historical Society on bringing out the artwork from downstairs with Sue Adrian and her team, basically the history of the community. You might see some of those photographs over the art gallery, but we're looking at placing those throughout the walls of the facility. But we will be seeking the feedback from the community in that respect to see how we can serve them better. The design, the floor space layout, and how we utilize the space from a staff perspective, we have to consider some of those needs. But from a decorating perspective, we're still looking for the input on that. So that's what we've got today, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. And comments, questions? Councillor Krog, then Councillor O'Doherty.
Do we have a timeline of when they're going to be looking at the upstairs and the redesign so it's a lot nicer for the public and stuff? Do we know when?
Yeah, so yeah. What we're planning on is we've been inundating council with so many workshops, Mr. Mayor, with the budget and all those different things, yeah. The communications piece and the AKBLD stuff, so understanding that respect to council's time, we are actually planning on something for later on this month or early in April to have a workshop with council to figure out what you've seen, what you think we need to do in the layout, because I know council's been talking about the layout, the old pieces of the desks that were up there, looking at the you know, what type of screens you'd like to have, whether it's the whiteboard or how do you want to present it. We'd actually like to invite Les in for that workshop as well, because he's the fellow that's doing all the filming, making sure we don't miss anything in that respect. Working with our IT people, with Daniel and the engineering department. So yeah, we plan on having all those pieces brought in to gather all that data so we can bring it back.
Okay, thank you.
Councillor O'Doherty.
When are we planning to start in the bottom, and how long will it take roughly?
Well, the construction piece right now, I'm meeting with the manager of engineering tomorrow to talk with the piece where we've been in contact with the insurance agency again, or the insurance company again, over some of the challenges. We had an estimate came back to the city based on the estimated damage, and we didn't feel as though it was accurate. I felt as though it was short by a couple $100,000. We found about $90,000 in accuracies. So we're trying to make sure we can agree on that first.
Okay.
So they've agreed to cut a check to the city in the name of the city for $374,000. On that. The $374,000 that we're going to be receiving?
I think $376,000.
$376,000. So they're giving us $376,000, which will allow us to start the process. That would be the initial amount that we'll receive. We're still going to be having the discussion around how much money you're going to be giving back to the city from the insurance company's perspective. We're going to be planning on using that money to finish off, to go to start the construction, but right now we still have to develop the tender, which we're doing. We're working right now with a mechanical engineer and electrical engineer, because of the room design, and we have to figure out those pieces in there, how we're going to heat and cool the building. We're looking at grant opportunities right now as well to see if we can bring in the standards up from an environmental footprint perspective. We want to make sure that we are insulating the building, thinking for the future, making sure that we are in a position right now where we've been displaced, but we want to make sure we get this right. We've looked at things from water efficiencies, looking at it from a heating perspective, whether we can use instantaneous hot water, those types of things, so we can reduce the amount of water consumption. We want this building to be as green as we can do it without utilizing the lead and stuff, because that becomes very convoluted, but that's what our goal is as a team right now.
Thank you.
Okay. Further questions, Council? And a motion to accept the verbal report. Councillor Wyers, Councillor Smith, all those in favor. Thank you very much. And bring us down to questions from the public and media. Can we raise our hands if we're going to be presenting tonight? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. And I think we should start with...
Is Lee here? Thank you, Mr. Mayor and members of the council. I will try to be just as quick as I can and take 4 minutes and 59 seconds. If you would humor me, I do have some pieces of paper that I will give you. They look formidable. They will take about 10 seconds of your time for each page. But there is some reference material here that I really would like to share with you and have you to look over.
Very unusual, but can you identify yourself?
Yes, I'm sorry. My name is Beverly Tripp. I'm a fairly recent resident from to Grand Forks, and I see I'm getting halted, or he's getting.
Mr. Mayor, as part of the process, when we get the agenda information, we try to make it available so all the public can see it in advance. If council gets this information at this point, it's contrary to the procedure bylaw, which won't allow the public to have access to it and review it before the meeting.
In the meeting?
In the meeting, yes. So
you could give us that material after the meeting?
After the meeting. We give it to the corporate officers, and we disperse it, and then we present it out as part of the information as well to all the public.
Okay, that's fine. Okay. So if that could be held there then for you.
Certainly. And your comments?
Yes, I'd like to talk about something that I hope will still have some input and weight into your deliberations about water meters. I think it is an issue that probably hasn't received a lot of proper and valid information at this point. I don't know if you're aware of the definition of electro-hypersensitivity.
Yes.
Okay, this is a functional impairment. It's listed in the UN Convention of Human Rights. People with EHS, that's what they call the short form for it, react exactly the same way to EMF radiation as other people do to plutonium, to uranium, to X-rays, to all of those things that cause radiation and kill. Some of the most common symptoms of people with EHS are stuffy nose, sinus problems, sore blisters in the mouth, taste of metal in the mouth, dry mouth, unusual thirst, vision and eye difficulties, dizziness, nausea, faintness, headache, depression, recent memory loss, unusual fatigue, difficulty concentrating, cramps, tingling, numbness, breathing difficulties, heart palpitations. In fact, these people are considered to be the canaries in the coal mine. For we all receive EMF and RF radiation just the same way. We are only not as sensitive. It has been scientifically proven that when these people are shielded from EMF and RF radiation, their symptoms, those critical symptoms, and there's many more, disappear. All people with this functional impairment are entitled to have an equal life in society based on equality, which our democratic society is. Now, I want to tell you, and I'm sorry that you won't be able to see these until later, and the visuals on here are fairly small, so if you need a magnifying glass, please let me purchase one for you, because the print is tiny. But there are over 25,000 published scientific papers on the dangers of EMF and RF radiation. We here in North America are in like this little biotech bubble. And the telecommunications industry here has kept from us vital information to our health that the rest of the world have made very drastic decisions on. Don't believe me. Believe what I was going to, what you would be have been following through to see, and I'm so sorry you can't. I'm going to flip through these very...
Actually, I'll ask you to speed it up a bit because we have about 8 other people waiting.
Okay. Each one of these pages has a very simple little cut line on it. It's from Dr. Ollie Johansson. He's a PhD, Department of Neuroscience, Karolinska Institute, Stockholm, Sweden, speaking to a group of physicians in Barcelona, Spain in November of 2013 about the dangers of EMF radiation. There's a website there. Please, you owe it to yourself and your children and your grandchildren to check that website out.
All right, thanks.
I have a couple of more things to say. He goes on to say how this is damaging our DNA. The effect is cumulative on our cells. It is cumulative. Biological effects at very, very low radiation frequencies. What happened after he gave this report to the WHO and also to the European Union was they set their rates for radiation frequency way down from where it was. 10,000 times lower than where we are currently at. They have recommended that no Wi-Fi be put in homes, on schools, in any public places where children are, because it irrefutably destroys our DNA. It's all here. You will see it for yourself. I'm not a scientist. I'm just a concerned citizen. But we must begin to take this into consideration when we think about putting Wi-Fi devices on our homes. Please, this is what water meters are. It's a Wi-Fi device. And I need to ask you, I have so much more, and I'm sorry that I can't.
Please, yes, it is a long.
I'm going to the end. Conclusion. In a letter I wrote to the Boundary Kootenai Sentinel, I pointed out that RF radiation has been upgraded from a possible carcinogen to a probable carcinogen by scientists. Do you know what frequency these meter readers run on? How much EMF radiation comes off of them? How are they sending? Are they pulsed? Or are they sending, or are they emitting constantly? You need to know these things before you install them on our homes. Do you feel that in all good conscience you can put Wi-Fi water meters in homes where children and people with VHS live?
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. And I really, really hope, please, look at that those reports and check out that website.
Thank you. Thank you, Mayor and City Council. David Jansen. I live in Triangle Gardens. You may know where that is behind the shell. The station is a mobile park. Surprisingly enough, I'm in favor of water meters, which I know is unusual. I'm not so sure the process was carried out correctly, but I am in favor of them. I'm going to suggest, and this is just a suggestion, I'm going to suggest 1 meter for all of Grand Forks. Okay, 1 meter. We average out the price. So the person with the garden, the person with 4 kids, the one person, we all pay the same. Of course, that's stupid, right? It's absolutely stupid. It doesn't accomplish anything, and it certainly does not conserve water. So how about 1 meter for every road? Now, at the top of your road, you have a meter, which is good for everybody down the road. That's the widow at the end and the people with 4 kids up the front. Everybody pays the same. That's stupid as well. That's not the way to conserve water. It's not the way to do it. Well, the owners of Triangle Park sent us a letter. Let me just read it to you in part. The city has proposed that a single meter be installed to measure water consumption for all the Triangle Gardens instead of individual meters for each mobile home pad, which is exactly what I just said was so stupid. Why should 48 units be averaged out when we have people with a pool? We have some people that wash their car 2 or 3 times a week. We have people that water their lawns every day. I wasn't supposed to say that, but that's the truth. And why should we always get that averaged out so that there's no incentive to conserve water whatsoever? We are individual taxpayers, and we each own our own home. Having 1 meter for everyone will foster anger among the residents. We certainly will not be happy with the fellow across the road who waters their car 3 times a week. He's going to be looked upon as costing everybody in that park more money. 1 meter will lower the chances of us selling our home. For who would like to move into a place where 1 meter serves 50 places? Just doesn't make any sense, and we're hoping council will consider that. We have a petition. It says, basically, it'll only be 1 more minute. Vendors signed residents of Triangle Gardens at 7225 Bondi Drive, Grand Forks, respectively, demand that each unit in Triangle Garden has its own water meter. It is served. It is signed by 56 residents, 56 votes.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
That's
Thank you.
So I'm just to comment to council on this, because it's not a debate, we're receiving information, is that I have discussed this, and I'm kind of out of the closet in supporting David's argument here, but this is not quite the time yet when we'll make that decision, but we will have an opportunity as those meters are planned out in specific areas to recognize this kind of an argument, and I think it adds a lot of weight. So thank you, David.
Thank you.
And further comments? Come on up.
Well, I'm not provided the context for my comments anyway. I'll leave these with you, I guess I can't hand them out. But basically, it's the same thing, it's not a problem actually with the water meters, it's with the, it being split between 50 people.
Can you identify yourself?
Oh, I'm sorry, I'm Laurie Hess, and I'm in Triangle Gardens as well. And so, yeah, we did actually, Mayor Taylor and I did exchange a couple emails in January, and it sounded, I thought the matter was actually kind of late to rest, and then we received this letter from the landowner in February. And so I was kind of hoping for some clarification or some reassurance that that wasn't going to be the situation, but I will leave these with you.
Okay. I'm not going to debate.
Yes, Councillor Krog.
Yeah, just, I guess, and there's been lots of support for the concept of separate meters. Where it comes from, or the concept is an apartment block with 50 units in it. They don't put water meters in each unit. There's one that goes into the unit. And Triangle Gardens is kind of a hybrid. It's halfway between, so it's
no,
not a separate.
Hybrid. No.
Okay, Councillor Krog, you were opening a debate.
Yeah.
Thank
and
you for your.
Opinion. It's between an apartment and a house, is what I'm trying to say.
Okay.
And they don't own the land.
Councillor Krog.
Okay.
No debate.
Yeah.
I'm going to be excused. Yes, please.
But we are going to. No, sorry, I stop that. That's part of the discussions that we're going to be doing. We're looking at it like, where do they fit? How is this going to work to make it work for everybody, for the city, the residents? So we're still going to be looking for volunteers to help us when we set all of this stuff, rates and everything like that. So
yeah, we've got a lot of work to do on this yet and a lot of decisions to make. So.
And I wasn't saying anything against it. It was just
pointing out. Can I ask them what your timeline will be in making those decisions?
On who gets meters and who doesn't, like where we would extend that. Could you give us some ideas, Mr. Allen?
Mr. Mayor, once we complete the RFP process and we review the RFPs, I'll be bringing a report back to council. And depending on, you know, what's happening in there, council will make the decision on some of the things that we've heard, because we've heard from multiple customers that are, you know, they're in favor of the water meters. They're just asking some similar questions. So we want to formulate a report. So we're hoping to have that report to council probably in early, by the end of April for sure. That'll allow us enough time to proceed with the information that we have. And then we'll come to council with that information, let me know what we've heard. And at that time, we'll have known who the proponent is that's going to be doing the installation of the meters. And then what will happen is there'll be, as part of that process, there'll be the open house for the customers to come in and meet the installation company and to talk about, you know, the different questions they would have with working with them, signing up for appointments for the installation, and those types of things. So there'll be a lot of information coming to council in April.
Thank you. So I'm hearing the end of April, beginning of May.
Okay, but we would like to be informed before it comes down to just the installation.
Yes, you will. There will be open house and opportunities for input. And further.
First, I'd like to follow up on the last regular council meeting. I had asked about, is council legally able to create a bylaw affording an opportunity for residents to sign petitions that are binding?
And the answer is no.
At this point, Mr. Mayor, the advice that we had is that's what's called the referendum that just basically strips council of all of those of the power. So it's not recommended.
So you're not legally able to create a bylaw that allows residents to have a binding petition? Is council legally allowed to do that?
We can bind our community and ourselves.
You can bind yourself. If we were to do that, then we would have to spend the money. If council wanted me to go and ask that question to the lawyers, it would be an expense for us to do that, so $500 or $700, to talk to the lawyer for an hour about that, get the full explanation. But the thing is, council has the ability to bind themselves. The community charter, the law is first and paramount. Council can then set their own standards within their own procedure bylaw. So if council so chooses to do that, they can make their own rules, so to speak.
Okay, so I'm...
Within the rules of the law.
Right, within the rules of the law. So it is possible, I guess.
Okay, thank you. That's important. You also referred to the ALR in this meeting earlier. So with the community engagement event coming up at the Omega, being at the same time as the ALR rally, how can council and participants show support for the ALR event at Selkirk, which is happening at the same time?
Yeah, being in two places at once is going to be difficult. My attention will be on the Omega and the event there. There will be an opportunity, I guess, for input at other times.
Mr. Mayor, the situation with the Omega was an event being hosted by the Association of Kootenai Boundary Local Governments. So it's Councillor Wyers sits on that committee, and this was something that they were working on from a communication workshop objective for. Was it part of the council's strategic, whether by the executive strategic priorities to do this?
By the strategic plan that we did last summer, yes.
Yeah,
and executive of AKBLG in conjunction with the Columbia Basin Trust.
So, Mr. Mayor, there was some bantering around regarding dates. So we had chosen this date a while back before we knew about the ALR piece. There was no, there was nothing. It was basically, we were given a couple of options, and there was some conflicting regional district meetings.
And it is the pilot project for three communities. So there's Fruitvale on the 11th, and Cranbrook is the 12th, and we're the 12th, and Cranbrook is the 13th. So it's strategic that this information is accumulated from these three pilot project communities for the conference in Creston on April the 9th.
Right, but in fact, the Corky Evans team and group have been moving around the province to different locations, so I've actually sat in on a session already.
So have I.
Would the council be willing to send a letter of support to the rally that a representative could read?
You saw the debate here tonight. It wasn't very lively. Councillor Krog had some opinions. If we were to send a letter of support, I think we'd have to dedicate some time to a more in-depth discussion of the ALR issues facing us. But given the fact that this is a meeting taking place in 2 days, no, I would think we can't really do that at this point.
Okay, as an update, in 4 days, we decided to allow residents to sign the previous petition longer. So in 4 days, we've collected over 100 more signatures for the petition. Councillor Krog and Councillor Wyers, we were happy that you attended the event at Gyro Park with residents who do not wish to have water meters forced into their residences and want discussions and a referendum vote. Councillor Krog, I'd like to refer to your statement earlier today at this meeting. More input makes for a better system. So, Councillor Krog, I'm curious, what were the results of the request of you to ask council to have a town hall meeting to clearly focus on the discussion of the pros and cons of water meters?
Yes.
We were asking to have, there's many things that we haven't been able to discuss. I think basically I'm getting the impression that council thinks that maybe we don't understand their reasons, and we're concerned that maybe you haven't considered certain things. And there are also residents who are feeling discouraged and concerned. And so we're asking, can we have a meeting focused on this? In these meetings, our time is limited to talk with you. You're noticing that it's very hard. So we would like to have a chance to talk with you about pros and cons of water meters, to hear what you would like to share with us, and for us to share with you, and hopefully you would also listen with an open mind.
So. Thank you, Tom.
Okay.
And further, Mona, Zach.
Go ahead.
Okay.
Evening, Council and Mayor Taylor. Les.
Bit off topic, I guess, but basically, you all hopefully have a bit of an idea who I am. I've been, for about the last 7 years or so, I've been trying to bring music into the city, putting on events, music-related events, and I've sort of, long story short, I've ended up with doing about one event a year on around Canada Day, and I'm planning it again this year. And I submitted a member request last week, a little bit late on the use of the city park, but I just basically give you guys a heads up that I am, I appreciate the support you've given me over the past, providing me with venue and lots of manpower and everything else, and hopefully I can continue to get your support. And basically, last year was funded by the Community Futures, so that is a bit of an issue for me, is funding again for this year. We'll be rallying for donations from the community again, but perhaps the city might consider pitching in, or maybe further down in the future, but basically just here thanking you for your past support, and hopefully I'll continue to get support for the Canada Day concert event, and you know, continue to grow, and I guess just remind you that basically I do it as a volunteer thing, and hopefully that's appreciated, and wants to, and you guys will continue to support me with this venture. And that's about it. I'm not really asking for anything. It's pretty open-ended, but hopefully you guys will continue to support me with this. And then
exactly. You guys appreciate your tenacity.
Yeah. And the volunteerism that goes into the events.
So, yeah, hopefully you'll have something good for Canada Day this year.
Yeah. No. It's in the works, right on. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, we're open to further comments.
Anything else? Just to follow up with you again on the water meter issue, our group has received an email from Coralie Oakes, BC Minister of Community Sport and Cultural Development, and I just wanted to clear up some misconceptions that seem to have been floating around in the media and the public. This letter is in response to one that was written to her, and it says, in response to your concerns regarding infrastructure grant funding, I assure you that the province of British Columbia does not require local governments to build new assets before applying for funding. You commented on the installation of water meters, and while they are not a requirement for funding, they do support sound asset management, in turn helping the local government to be in a better position to meet funding criteria for drinking water related infrastructure projects. So clearly here the minister is stating that we do not need to install water meters in order to get our grant funding.
I would certainly not interpret that statement as a fellow politician with Coralie Oakes. That's really clear to me. They're not going to fund anybody that doesn't have that kind of a positive water management program in place. She's saying what we're hearing.
She says that you're not required to install new assets to get funding.
We're not
she
required.
Says that you do need to show sound asset management.
Yes.
I think that the city has done that with the many studies that you've done and the different things that you've shown over the past couple of years.
I don't want to debate it either, but in fact, if I could share with you the situation in Kelowna, it's exactly the same, and there's an article in the Kelowna paper yesterday that had the same wording in terms of if you don't have the asset management and your water management plan in place. Certainly they're not saying they won't give us money, but they're not going to.
Okay, that's your interpretation of it. The other issue I wanted to speak on tonight was regarding McDonald's application.
Yes.
And the branding that Grand Forks has done. I'm just curious to know what type of community it is that we're trying to portray. Are we somebody unique? Are we having good cultural opportunities? Are we promoting health in our community? And just speaking personally, I don't see any positive aspects that McDonald's would bring to our community. Talking about a youth center, McDonald's will be your youth center. It will be where the kids hang out. It will cause more RCMP problems probably in the area. It certainly doesn't encourage health for our youth. And I mean, if you're looking at taxes, I guess they'll be able to pay some more taxes to the city. But I think it would be an unfortunate way of removing Grand Forks from a unique community. I don't hear people saying, I moved to Grand Forks because they have a McDonald's. Okay. So I just wanted to mention that.
All right. Thank you very much. And further this evening, anyone else that wanted to come up and make comments? Mr. Johnson.
Septic cards? I've never heard that before.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I just wanted to, I'm not sure, maybe Councillor Kendel might remember this, but in the late 80s, Saskatchewan, in the urging to do something good about the environment, be good stewards of their environment and stuff. They enacted a whole bunch of laws. And what the unintended consequences of that was they destroyed most of the small towns, like the really small villages within the province, because small villages were clustered around a mom and pop gas station / grocery store / post office. And when the province came in to them and they said, well, you have a tank in the ground, now you need an assessment. And the assessment started around $40,000-$50,000 and sometimes went up $100,000. And most of these mom and pop operations, what happened was they could not afford this. So they had to literally walk away from it. And when their business died, the little cluster of everything else that was around there pretty much dried up, and people who used to drive 20 miles to get to that because it was a local area cluster, it's at the center of everything, and now had to drive 60, 70 miles to a bigger center. And I'm just, whatever it is this is about, I'm just saying be careful what you actually enact and do, because you could trigger off something else and have no choice in the matter after that, and people could end up in big expensive doo-doo. That's it.
And I think that we're hearing that at this point from our administrator, that clearly this was not an action recommendation, but you better know that this is happening in your community, that we have these kinds of problems. But I hope we don't alarm people that we're going out there with metal detectors looking for tanks right now. Thank you very much. And last call. All right, motion to adjourn. Thank you very much, everyone.